So we're looking at Cicero, and this is a classic dialogue, sort of a dialogue. It's not like a Platonic dialogue like you've read before. And it's on friendship. The Latin term for it is actually kind of important to know. Because Cicero will actually make some hay of this. Amicitia is friendship. And it comes from the same word as the word for love or desire. So when you feel love in the sense, we would, you know, we talk about being amatorious or things like that. That's coming from this notion of love, much more like romantic love, but amor could cover the whole gamut, you know, the love that parents have for children and vice versa, the love that fellow citizens, however weak, might have for each other, the love that friends exhibit towards each other. Those are all forms of that. And the thing that ties them together is this verb, amare, to love, to feel affection. And one of the things that we've seen over the course of studying these different texts is there's different kinds of love, right? We began the semester talking about that. Friendship is seen as one kind of love, but is there just one thing called friendship? As it turns out, there's a lot of different things that people do call friendship. So we want to be able to pin these down. This is an important text, not just because it's raising interesting questions and giving you some answers to some of them and then leaving you with some further questions, but because it influenced a whole bunch of other people after Cicero in their thinking about love. So medieval monks, you know, who are doing a very different kind of thing. They're withdrawing from the world. They're giving up any sort of, at least in theory, some of them actually didn't give this up entirely, any sort of conjugal relations, you know, husband and wife kind of thing. They're putting that aside. They're bringing in Christian conceptions of love as something like, you know, agape, self-giving love. But they thought that this was worth reading, and they thought that this was worth thinking about and talking about and incorporating into their own ideas about love and friendship. And they had to deal with the same issues of friendship that you guys do. They just did it in a monastery. Monks sometimes don't get along. They're stuck living in a dorm room. You know, sometimes you don't like your roommate. Imagine that you're going to be with your roommate the rest of your life. That would be like what a monastery could be like. So some real issues here. And Cicero is writing, you might say, sort of at the apex of the Roman Empire. Well, it's really before it becomes the empire, isn't it? Because he's a contemporary with the guy who makes it into an empire. Who's that? Anyone remember offhand? Yeah.
Augustine.
What's that?
Augustine.
Well, Augustine is a later Christian thinker, and Augustus is the second of the emperors. Who was the guy who took absolute power?
Caesar.
Julius Caesar. Yeah. The word Caesar comes to mean emperor, sort of like a trade name, almost. But it was actually just part of his name. Gaius Julius Caesar. Actually, Caesar. And Cicero is a contemporary of his. There were a lot of disturbances going on in Rome. It was expanding into something that would become, you know, a full-fledged empire and rule a large part of the world. Cicero is one of the most highly placed people in Roman culture. He was a jurist, you know, what we'd call a lawyer in our day. He would argue cases. He wrote speeches for people. He participated in political deliberations. He knew a lot of people. He also played a major role in transferring philosophy from Greece to Rome. And a lot of people think of him as just being kind of like a translator, you know, somebody who takes something from one place and then translation literally means to carry it over, to bring it somewhere else. He did a bit more than that. I think when you're looking at this dialogue, you see some themes that are connected to people that we've looked at, like Plato and Aristotle and Epicurus. But he's doing something a bit more. So we'll look at that. I think in a lot of ways, Caesar, Cicero is closer to where you are than Plato was, or even Aristotle. So let's start out with this. Is it a dialogue? Kind of. Who are the characters? There's really only one person talking, right? There's this little framing of, I heard these conversations and sort of stored them up in my memory because they were very useful. It's recounted by Scaevola, who is a priest in the Roman religion. And Cicero is telling about that. And then Scaevola, what's he telling about? Well, we had this conversation a while back with somebody who himself is now gone, my father-in-law, Laelius, and another one of the sons-in-laws, Gaius, where is it? Fannius. And why is he recounting this? Well, because Laelius is supposed to have been a very wise man. So this is sort of like you sitting around. How many of you come from big families where you have many generations and quite a few cousins and you get together every once in a while and people tell old stories? Not too many of you are from large families. I'm kind of surprised because usually here at Marist a lot of people are. When you're sitting around and people are telling you these stories about what so-and-so said back in the day, at your age that tends to be very boring, I think. Am I right? As you get older, that stuff becomes more and more valuable. And I'm not saying that you have to, you know, change the way that you view things right now and try to, you know, make an effort to listen. Because, Cicero would say it's just not that time of life for you. But as you get older, you start to realize that some old people are, in fact, wise. Are all of them wise? Definitely not. Just look at their lives and see how they screwed them up and screwed up their relationships and made the wrong choices at different places, and didn't even manage to cull any wisdom out of that. But are some of them wise? Yeah. And if you're lucky enough to have anybody like that in your life, you want to listen to them. You want to get a hold of that, because this stuff is kind of like gold. Think about this for a minute. This is a sort of guiding question for this entire dialogue. Friendship is very important, isn't it? For all of you? And other kinds of relationships are very important for you too, right? Your family, romantic relationships. Now, if it's that important, how do you get things right? How do you figure out not just what to do, not just like having a set of rules or a code, but how do you figure out what sort of distinctions to make? What sort of ways to classify things? Maybe that's actually a better starting point than thinking about, you know, the dialogue within the dialogue or stuff like that. How do you learn, well, about friendship, love, desire, the things that you're going to be occupied with and that are going to have huge effects in your life the rest of your life, and they're going to affect other people's lives? I mean, you could go on websites, right? Aren't there plenty of websites giving relationship advice? Have any of you looked at them? Do you find them good? Have any of you looked at websites that have relationship advice once in a while? Where do you get your information, your knowledge about relationships, then? Yeah.
Family and friends.
Okay. Now notice, that could work really well if you've got really smart family and friends. Or really well squared away family and friends. People who, if they've made some mistakes, they've recovered from the mistakes, and they figured out what they did wrong, and then they drew some lessons from that for the future. If you've got that sort of thing in your life, that's great. A lot of times family and friends are actually the problem because they give you bad advice.
I think you have to take like a survey of like a lot of people that you know, and then, I mean, obviously some people that you think in your life,
Yeah, we you check people against each other, right?
Yeah.
That's a good idea. When I have to make an important, difficult decision, like the decision to move up here, for example, to leave a full-time tenure-track job where I was about to move into being an associate professor and get tenure and probably become the person responsible for assessment at the entire university and for implementing a tenure plan. I moved up here. And now I'm adjuncting. Why did I do that? Well, because I decided I wanted to be in the same, well, we decided that we wanted me in the same place as the person who I was going to marry, my wife, who I went to high school with, and then reconnected up with many, many years later, and who I think is, you know, the one. So that was a big decision. And before I make decisions like that, I do exactly what you're talking about. Now, I don't ask everybody. I don't like I don't do like a go up, you know.
Send that
do
it. Email.
I only ask people that I think are going to bring something to the conversation.
Right. But before you know that, you have asked those other people and you kind of know like, oh, this person is not really.
Who can't give good advice?
Yeah.
That's true. You need to sound people out. And it's not a bad idea, actually, to ask people relationship advice ahead of time. Just to figure out who the dummies are that you don't want to ask next time. Ask them about something that's not even a real relationship problem, just to see if they get crazy responses. But I asked like about eight friends, eight different people. And then you kind of compare, you know, their responses to each other. That's a good way to do it. How else could you do it? How else could you get ideas about, yeah?
Like art.
Okay. Now, it's interesting that you said art. Do you mean paintings?
Well, like movies, like...
Exactly.
Yeah.
Go ahead. Keep going on with that. Movies, what else?
Like TV shows, music, and like paintings.
Okay, so the art is what the Greeks and Romans would have called poetry, right? And what you're right, what we call today film, TV, we've got this weird blurred kind of thing now, like our Netflix series that are purely Netflix, do they count as TV because there's no TV channel? Well, let's just call it media in general, right? How do we get our ideas about relationships and what sort of distinctions we ought to make, what sort of rules we ought to give ourselves? How do we get that from film and TV or even songs? Yeah.
Usually Nicholas Sparks books.
What's that?
Nicholas Sparks books.
Nicholas Sparks books. What are
notebook.
Oh,
very defining thing.
Very romantic movies. Yeah. I suppose we could also put novels, and would we put anything else in here? What are other things that we consume as artwork that tells us about life? Music, right? Can you think of any other? Yeah.
Magazines, maybe?
Yeah, you know, insofar as magazines are, we could call this art or we could call this maybe culture in general. What else? Are there other resources that you could avail yourselves of? Yeah, friends and family. Yeah.
Well, so like asking a friend's family, like what's experience something, but like what about their experience of it?
Yeah, and even also your own experience too, right? Hopefully, when you make trial and error, hopefully when you make the errors, the next time you don't make the same error, you figured something out. There's an old joke about relationships, and it's kind of bitingly true. If you have a lot of relationships and they always end badly, it's probably not the people in the relationship's fault. There's one common element to it, and that's you being in the relationship. So something you're doing is probably, you know, setting things up or contributing to the breakdown. Experience. It's better to learn from other people's bad experience, but sometimes it doesn't work, right? You hear from your friend, don't go out with him, don't go out with her, because so-and-so did, and they had a terrible time with them. Yeah, it'll be different for me. And how well does that turn out usually? so good, right? And then you learn, maybe I should actually pay attention to family and friends. Another resource would be actually, you know, philosophy. Nowadays we have psychology. There's people who are relationship experts. You know, you'd have to sound them out, see if they're making the right distinctions and things like that. It's interesting because if you say listen to the radio shows with relationship experts, who do you think they actually sound like the most? They sound a lot like Cicero, or a lot like Plato, or a lot like Aristotle. They're making the same sort of distinctions. They're going through the same sort of reasoning processes. Philosophers were doing this earlier on. So let's now think about different kinds of relationships that we have, and whether Cicero can actually tell us anything useful about them. What are the relationships in which we feel affection, or we act good to other people, or we feel connected with them in different ways? What's the whole range? What's the whole gamut? Who do you have involved in your life? Okay, so we'll call this romantic relationship. Generally done one at a time, although people sometimes make exceptions, right? I had a friend who, I don't think I've told you about him yet, have I? Well, Marshall. He's been dead over 20 years. He died very young, unfortunately. He was my best friend, actually. He was going to be the best man at my wedding. He had a weird thing. He could never be monogamous. And the weird thing with him, it wasn't that, and there's a lot of people who cheat, it was that he would always go out with some, you know, pretty good-looking girl, and who was usually pretty squared away, emotionally, psychologically, usually came from a, you know, fairly good background. And then he would, like, go down the ladder, and he would find himself somebody to cheat on her with, invariably, within like a matter of weeks. And he would always find somebody who was less good looking and less squared away to be the cheaty, I guess, the girl on the side. Then sometimes he'd have like three relationships in the air at the same time. And that one would always be even less good looking. And usually, like, all sorts of psychological problems. And at first I was like, I wonder if he realizes that this is kind of crazy. And we were all like, what are you doing? You know, don't cheat on so-and-so. I mean, look at the person that you're cheating with. Are you crazy? And, you know, he'd, like, nod and say, yeah, I understand. But he'd just keep doing it. And then invariably, he would lie to all these girls. He didn't lie to us, but he lied to all these girls. And pretty soon you lose track of who you lied to, about what thing, and it all falls apart. And then you'd think he'd have learned his lesson, and, you know, he'd start going out with somebody nice, and he'd be like, all right, great, you're going to be great for Marshall. And what we should have realized, Marshall's not going to be great for you. Because sooner or later, he'd find, you know, some other girl to cheat with, and then he'd be like, what are you doing? What's wrong with you? But after a while, we just realized this was the way he was. So, best often, just one at a time, right? You mentioned family relationships. So let's divide it into two kinds of family relationships, because that's the way Cicero deals with it. You got family as parents and children, and you have family as what he calls kindred. We'll come back to that in a moment. What other people are you in association with? Connected with, in any way. Yeah?
Like your colleagues?
Okay.
People that you wouldn't consider like your friends?
Colleagues. Am I misspelling that? Good, because sometimes words look funny to me, like I might be misspelled.
Oh, G-U-E-S.
G-U-E-S?
Yep.
There you go, see? Good illustration of what Cicero's talking about in, you know, certain relationships being based on need. I actually need somebody to like straighten out my spelling. Thank God we have a spell check because I misspell so many words. So colleagues, I suppose Cicero would say that those fit in to this larger spectrum of, you know, like fellow citizens, people that you're involved with in some sort of, let's call this a common affair. Right? So if you're on a team with people, that would be that sort of thing. Cicero is thinking in larger terms, political terms like fellow citizens. I don't know that we necessarily feel affection towards all Americans these days. If you're overseas, then suddenly you start rediscovering that kind of thing. Sometimes it depends on contrast. Who else? Who else are involved in our lives? We do have friends, right? And Cicero wants to say that we should understand friends as being in a couple different classes. So this is similar to Aristotle, in that there are friends that are in terms of goodness. Now let's call these real friends. And then there's friends in terms of pleasure, need, usefulness, security, those sorts of things. So, you know, you get to campus, and you go through that orientation thing. How long did your orientation last? About a week or so?
Day.
Just a day? Wow. You guys learn quick. Or Marist doesn't think there's much to teach you. And then you're thrown into a dorm room, I guess, most of you. And do you have a single room, or do you guys have doubles? Doubles? Depends. Yeah. So a lot of you have to make an association right off the bat. Even if you like ignored everybody you were in orientation with, which they probably didn't allow you to do, right? There was ice-breaking activities. Introduce yourself to the other person. This is the sort of stuff we tend to do, right? Why? Because it builds a kind of an association. But, you know, it's just being next to the other person and maybe having a few things in common. It's not yet at the level of we connect on, you know, with our hearts and I die for them, that sort of thing. If you form that sort of relationship in orientation, you're a little bit too quick to latch on to other people. You might be a stalker, right? Or there might be something else going on. Cicero recognizes there's all these different sorts of things. And all of these are similar to friendship. All these involve something like friendship and affection to some degree. This is natural. As a matter of fact, he talks about, you know, parents and children, when things are going normally, kids have to do something really, really wrong before parents will disown them. Now, if you've got a screwed up family, you know, we call it a dysfunctional family, maybe that's not what, like, Cicero is describing. Maybe Cicero is idealizing a bit here. Maybe he had too easy of a life. But you get the idea. There's a natural affection between parents and children. And even between children and other children. We get a little bit wider and we're in this realm of kindred. And that's people that you're connected with by family. So who would that count as in our society? Maybe your cousins, if you're in touch with your cousins. Do you feel like you owe anything to your cousins? Do you feel any sort of connection to them? I know I do, in part because we have a family reunion every year for 3 days. Where we get together, but I'm from a very different kind of family. You know, we trace ourselves back all the way to the 1600s, when Pierre Lefebvre comes over and becomes Pierre Lemaire's, and then it keeps on going and going and going. There's been a tight-knit family organization for, you know, the last 5 generations. And we've chosen to maintain that. But most people, that's not the case. But if somebody's your first cousin, do you feel a sort of sense of connection to them? Would it make you happier if they went to school here? Or would it just not matter to you at all? That would be a good test. Do you know who else is your kindred? In our culture, probably mattering a bit more than cousins. This only happened later on down the line. Who would it be? Yeah.
In-laws?
Exactly. Yeah. Your in-laws are family that you end up sort of stuck with, like it or not. And there are certain relations that are expected to come about because of that. And you can become very close with your in-laws. It helps if, you know, they're the kind of people that you can stand. And if their way of doing things in their house isn't radically different from yours, and if you don't fight about that. You know, there's always father-in-law, son-in-law, and mother-in-law, daughter-in-law tensions when people have very different ways of doing things, and they want to push it onto the other person. But sometimes they can be very close, and your in-laws can be a great help for you, a great resource. Sometimes they can become the parents you didn't have, that you would have liked to have had. Or you can become a son or daughter that they would have liked to have had, you know. Romantic relationships, can Cicero talk about this? Does he discuss this at all in his work? The only time that he mentions anything about marriages or, he only uses the term wife too, is when he's talking about rivalries. So maybe he doesn't have anything to say about romantic relationships. What do you think? From this text, from, you know, maybe once, twice, three times reading through it, is any of the stuff that he's saying in there applicable to your lives, 2013, and the kind of romantic relationships that you either are in, or have been in, or would like to be in, or are afraid of being in? If you screw things up. What do you think? Could any of this be applied, even though he's not talking about romantic relationships, could any of this be applied to them? I mean, romantic relationships are not family relationships, unless, you know, you're committing incest or something really weird's happening, right? You shouldn't be doing that. And oftentimes they come out of being colleagues, don't they? A lot of people meet their mates at work. Not usually a good idea, by the way, because if it breaks up, then now the workplace is kind of a tough place to be. Don't date somebody who's in all of your classes, because if you break up with them, now you're stuck seeing them the rest of the semester. Or if you're going to break up with them, break up like the last week of the semester, and then switch majors or something like that. Would romantic relationships be more like this? Like friend relationships, only involving what else? Sex, attraction, flirting, different kinds of gift giving. What do you think? Does that work? I mean, if a romantic relationship doesn't have elements of friendship to it, is that the sort of thing that you want? I mean, if all you want is sex, then that works out really well, right? But even with that, they talk about it as friends with benefits, don't they? Not just colleagues with benefits, I suppose. That would be an interesting benefit. So let's focus in on this. What is he going to talk about? There's this contrast running throughout the entire work where he's bouncing back and forth from the better kinds of friendships to the lesser kind of friendships. And that's part of the lesson. That's part of what makes this text a little bit hard to follow when you're first reading through it for the first, second, third time. He's going back and forth and back and forth. He doesn't stick to the topic and just say, okay, now I'm going to lay out all the characteristics in bullet point form of a real friendship. Now let's, compare it and contrast it to other kinds of things that we call friendship but really aren't friendship. So he organizes it instead into a bunch of different topics, a bunch of different questions, a bunch of different issues. So let's look at these. We'll see how many of these we can get through. Here's a startling assertion that he comes up with. This is almost word for word. Friendship can only exist between good people. Key term there being good, right? Why does he say that? He says this is not, he's not just like dropping this as a remark. He says this is a principle. This is a sort of starting point, a thing that you can take to the bank and put in your safe deposit box, and it's going to be just as good when you're 80 as when you're 18. Why would he say something like that? Think about all of your friends now. And I don't want you to just think about them, you know, in warm, fuzzy terms, you know, where we often say that people are good people when they're really not good people. Even if they're not necessarily bad people, there's a lot of people that are not good people in any real sense. How do you know somebody's a good person? They do good things. They have good dispositions. They don't make excuses for their behavior. They do the right thing without having to be watched, right? How many of our friends are actually, the people that we call our friends, how many of them are actually good people? If Cicero is right, that means that a lot of the people that we call friends aren't really friends in any real sense of the term. Even worse, are we good people? We like to think of ourselves as good people. That's a natural human tendency. Most of us tend to think of ourselves as better than we actually are. I mean, that's what leads us into all sorts of problems when we get into tough situations. That's when we find out whether we're really good people or not. Being a good person is a choice. It's not something you can take for granted. So if you want to be able to have friendship in any sort of full sense, you at least have to be on the way to goodness. That's kind of a scary idea. Because that means that unless you actually cultivate moral goodness, you're probably going to be lonely. And your friendships are not going to be able to sustain themselves over time. And we'll see why. He says, let's think, for example, first of all, what's the standard? So when we say good people, we don't mean not the philosophers. So, you know, we're not saying that the bar is set at this astronomic height that nobody can ever reach it. You know, the philosophical wise man, or think about, you know, with Christianity. What would it be for Christian thinkers? The saints, right? You know, the saints are way up here and the rest of the people are all down here. And then some are even lower than that. What does he mean then? He means, you know, sort of a common sense. And he thinks of examples. So, you know, he talks about, for example, he says, Gaius Fabricius, Manius Curius, Tiberius Coruncanius. These are all good people. Now, that doesn't mean anything to you, right? These are just Roman names. I could have just made some stuff up. Balbus Balbus. Who are good people that we know about? We could probably name a bunch. You know, if you think about, for example, let's, I'm not going to put anybody on the spot and you know, make them name names. Among your professors here that you've been interacting with for the last, what, 7 weeks? We're in week seven now, or week six? Is there anybody you would say, I can tell that person's really a good person? Because maybe you went to their office hours and you talked with them a bit, and they helped you out. And they didn't act like a jerk when you asked, you know, a question that might have not been the best question at the time. What about your RAs? You guys have been living with them day in, day out. Are there some who are complete jerks? Yeah? Are there some who are actually good people who could provide an example of the kind of person that you might like to be friends with? Yeah? Good. I hope that they are, because you know, I want you to be able to enjoy your lives. I don't want you to be stuck under the thumb of some tyrant RA, you know, who's just out there to make your life miserable. So he says, let's look at common sense examples. And you know, we could pick people in our culture. Probably we could look at movies and TV, you know, who's a good friend and what show. We probably have people in our family who fit the bill for that. And he says, we can contrast this against other sorts of relations, like what he calls moderate friendship. He talks about this as being, here we go. He says, talking about, you know, the real kind of friendship, not just the friendship that's based on usefulness or getting something out of somebody or just, you know, pleasure. But you know, real friendship. He says the way in which we're going to understand friendship is going to be dependent on the kinds of goods. So again, this term good comes in there. Our understanding of good, the goods that we make priorities. So what are different good things that we do in fact value, things that we pursue, things that we want? Bless you. Well, you know, some of the common places. Wealth. Are there people who value wealth more highly than personal relationships? Sure. You can find them all the time. A lot of times their lives turn out quite screwed up, and they only realize this at the end. But, you know, wealth can buy you certain kinds of personal relationships. There's a lot of people who say, I'm just going to make a ton of money, and then I can sort out the friendships and love affairs and stuff like that, because I've got enough that can attract people. Health. Health is a good thing, isn't it? Can you make health the center of your life, the center of all your thinking and your focus?
You can.
You can, yeah. I mean, you can like become, well, here'd be a great example. Some people are vegans, not just vegetarians, but vegans. And it's not because they give, you know, like, it's the, I don't want animals to suffer or stuff like that business, but just they think it's a healthier lifestyle. And actually, they tend to be less insufferable than the vegans who are all about animal liberation, because vegans like to get in your face quite often. They're often, you know, the most intolerantly tolerant people that you run across. Well, there's all sorts of forms of that. People get a, you know, an idea, a master idea in their head, and that's all they focus on. Because it becomes a priority for them. What about people who work out all the time? And that's all they think about, is how their body looks. And got to get in the workout, got to get in the run. Sorry, kids, can't spend any time with you. You got to do this instead. You can be excessive with that, can't you? That can become the dominant center of your life. Or hypochondriacs. People are always constantly concerned with getting sick, more on the negative end. People have to wipe every single door handle that they come across. It's hard to have a relationship unless you have a fellow hypochondriac to spend time with in that case. What else? Power. Position, you know, authority. Honor, or we would say prestige, respect. Some people are so much about getting respect that they make it very difficult to respect them. Because, you know, we respect people because they actually have good qualities. If you just come up to me and say, you've got to treat me respectfully, but you don't give me any reasons why I would actually respect you, that's not going to get very far, is it? And I've had, not here, but in other places, I've had students who do that sort of thing. And they're usually the students who don't show any respect to anybody else. Their fellow students, the texts, the school. Pleasure, sensual pleasure is something that we desire. Can you set up your entire life to be oriented around pleasure? Absolutely. People do this. You know, some people do it with, I mean, drug addiction is a very dangerous way to do that. But some people get pleasure through things that aren't quite so debilitating. Drinking, you know, if you drink all the time, that's not going to be good for you either. But, you know, other people pursue pleasure through sex, through just, you know, relaxing all the time. Video games could be just a constant source of pleasure. What else? Well, you can just run down the whole line. Think of anything that you can sell people because it's pleasant, and that can become the center. Even shopping itself can become a pleasure for some people. They become the so-called shopaholics, you know? They get a thrill out of shopping. Makes them feel alive, they say. You probably need a lot of wealth to do that. What else? Security. Particularly if people come from impoverished backgrounds or dysfunctional homes, oftentimes just having a sense of security can be an overriding priority for people. Appearance, or we would say fashion. He talks about appearance and dress. Then he talks about architecture. That's an interesting one too, isn't it? People become obsessed with their houses. They became obsessed with them in Roman times. They are just as obsessive now, or it's a danger. You know, people can become homebodies that are constantly, you know, fixing this or adding this, and they need people to come in and look at it and enjoy it with them. All these sorts of things are good things, aren't they? Nobody's saying that these are bad. Nobody's saying that wealth is something you should divest yourself of because it's going to ruin you or anything like that. But any one of these, when it becomes the main priority in a person's life, it's going to be somewhat of a damaged life. It's going to be a life lacking in some other thing, some other goods. What are other things that are good? Relationships, but we're talking about what the relationships would be based on. They could be based on all these things. What else could you actually care about and find good, orient your life with? He's got this term virtue, right? Maybe that doesn't really connect with you. You know, we don't use the term virtue a lot unless we're in church. Or, you know, I think there's some line of clothing out there called virtue. Yeah?
How is this, like, different from what Aristotle said about friendship?
Well, that's what we're going to get to. This is sort of leading into it. It's getting a somewhat fuller picture. You saw that when you read through the text, I'm sure. There were points where you said, this is very similar to Aristotle, and then you saw other points where you were saying, well, Aristotle didn't actually talk about appearance, for example.
No, but it's like the three friendships.
Yes, it's the same basic sort of classification filled out. But Cicero's going to introduce some other distinctions as well. So, what is virtue? We don't want to use that term, because we don't use it much in our society. What is it to be virtuous? If this is really key to what it is to have real friendships, we want to know this, don't we? So what is it to be virtuous, or to have a virtue? Yeah.
I don't know, you kind of hold yourself like a higher ethical code, I guess.
Okay, so virtue involves standards, and we're talking about moral virtue. if we put it less in terms of virtue as such, you know, with capital V, and we talk about virtues, what are character traits you want in a friend? These are like deal breakers. If they don't have this, you're not going to be friends with them forever. Yeah.
Genuineness. I don't know what the
trustworthiness.
Okay.
But being genuine.
Yeah, you're onto something that Cicero talks about. And this goes beyond. Here's a good example of something going beyond Aristotle. Cicero places a premium on sincerity, on what you're calling genuineness, trustworthiness. What were you going to say?
Loyalty.
Yeah, all these sorts of things. The Romans, it's not that the Greeks didn't conceptualize this at all, but the Romans tended to place a lot more emphasis on that. You see, you know, truthfulness being talked about in this over and over and over again. The friend, the real friend, is so truthful that they're actually willing to tell their friend, hey, you're screwing up. You better knock it off because you're acting like a fool. That's what we call admonition. Aristotle tended to portray things as if you've got these virtuous people and they're totally squared away and everything works out okay for them and they're good friends with each other because they recognize the good virtues in each other, the moral fiber. What about the rest of us who are sort of on the way to virtue, if at best? We're gonna screw up, right? Sooner or later you're gonna make a dumb choice. And you're going to need a friend to actually have the guts to say to you, knock it off. What the hell's wrong with you? You may actually need them to push you up against the wall and do that, to drive it home. Or to say to you, give ultimatums like, if you don't quit this, I'm not going to be able to hang out with you. And I'm not going to take your calls, and I'm not going to respond to your texts until you fix this. That's something that Cicero thinks is necessary for friendship. I mean, if you actually find somebody who's totally perfect, totally squared away, you won't have to run into that problem. You'll never have to tell them they're wrong. But sooner or later, if you're really friends with somebody, you will have to have the fortitude, the courage to say, you're screwing up, and I'm going to hold you to this standard. What else do you expect from your friends? What do you desire from them? Maybe you're not getting it from your friends. I don't know. But I hope someday you find people who you do get this from. What do you want from them? Yeah?
I try to explain that not gaining something like physically from them, but like learning things from them and like growing as like your friendship grows together.
Okay. Yeah, now that is something Cicero doesn't talk about, say, learning together. He does talk about how when we're living this life of virtue together, or like attempting to be virtuous, we end up getting to know the other person better and better and better. Romantic relationships have this element too, don't they? If you really are attracted to somebody and you don't just want to sleep with them, you want to know everything about them. You want to understand why they do things the way they do, why they like what they do. And it's interesting because when you uncover these sorts of things, you might uncover things that you don't like, right? In that case, the friendship is going to weaken. But you might uncover things where you're like, wow, you're even better than I thought. A lot of times in the beginning of romantic relationships, we get kind of blinded about this. We think that all sorts of things about the other person are cute or, you know, brilliant or so unusual. And then after the infatuation goes away, we're like, well, that trait that I really liked before, I don't like that anymore. Can you knock it off? Can you quit doing that? But in a real friendship, there is that element. Let's go on to consider now one of the other topics that he tackles at great length. So there's this classic question. Is friendship based on need, usefulness, or based on nature, similarity. We did see this with Aristotle. Aristotle said, look, one of the classic problems that people, you know, raise is friendship based primarily on difference, where we're friends with somebody so that we can have them supply to us what we don't have, and likewise, they're getting something out of it as well. So, for example, I'm friends with you because I can supply you with the homework, and you, in turn, will invite me to a nice party on the weekend. And then, you know, we'll find some other arrangement for the next week, right? Maybe homework for going to the mall, or homework for hanging out for a couple hours. It's always based on dependency, people swapping things back and forth. There are friendships like this, aren't there? That's why people would say, look, that's all friendship really is. Because there are friendships, or at least things we call friendships, that are like that. Or is the real ground for friendship similarity or connection in some sense? I mean, parents and children, they don't say to each other, look, I need something from you, you need something from me, let's get together and make a deal of it. Parents get together, have sex, babies, you know, appear, the babies have nothing to contribute. Absolutely nothing. You know, there are people who make babies, usually teenagers, and they're like, the baby's going to love me. It's going to give me the love I don't have in my life. Total nonsense. Babies are a pain in the rear. I mean, they cry. They're constantly dirty. You know, they smile once in a while. Usually it's because of gas. There's great things about babies, too. I'm not knocking them. But if the whole idea is, you know, there's some sort of swap going on, the baby is not holding up his or her end of the deal. And never will, you know. Later on down the line, when you like don't like your parents, you may have this, you know, sort of thing. The only reason I hang out with you at all is because I need the money that you're giving me, you know, pay for my education or a place to live or something like that. And you say things like that when you're angry, but most of the time you don't actually mean that. You're just doing what people do at that age. Maybe later on you meet somebody, and you know you do have arrangements where you're like, need a roommate. You need a roommate too? Let's split the rent. We'll hang out, we'll live together. That is a friendship based on that, isn't it? It's neat. Now, if it's going to become anything better, you have to find something you have in common. What Cicero's doing in this, and if you have to read between the lines to realize this, he's showing you that this isn't really the right question or set of questions to ask. It's not whether all friendship is based on this or based on that. It's really thinking about, well, what kind of relationship would come out of that? So if you look a little bit further when it comes to like the difference part, he tells you, you can't have anything really solid based on difference. Because that sort of thing is not going to last very long. He says, here we go. If this were true, then the less of resource one was conscious of having in oneself, the better fitted would he be for friendship. The more needy a person would be, the better a friend they could be. Now think about your own experience. Does that match up with it? The super needy, are they good friends? Do you want to be friends with the super needy, the clingy? I always want to get something out of you because even if you give me any money, I'm just going to, you know, like lose it, or I need some clothes because I'm careless of mine and tore them up, or I can't figure out what's fashionable and I bought all this stuff in the wrong place, or, you know, the people that just like, can't look out for themselves. Do you want to be friends with them? Probably not. He says the contrary is the case. The more confidence a person has in himself, the more thoroughly fortified by virtue and wisdom, the more noteworthy is the friendships that they have. A little bit later on, he approaches this issue again, and he says, let's not just consider like money or things like that. Consider a person's character. Do opposites really attract? Opposites attract in certain senses, right? If you're attracted to members of the opposite sex, there's an opposite that involves attraction, right? And, you know, do we, like, seek out people sometimes who are kind of different from us? If we're introverted, sometimes we like somebody who's a little bit more extroverted, because they'll actually, like, you know, say the things that we don't say. And sometimes the extroverted person likes an introverted person because they feel they have more depth, or at least they, you know, keep their mouth shut long enough to figure out what they ought to say. Are there other things like that that attract us to each other? You know, find out somebody's from a different background that's really interesting, you want to get to know them. It doesn't even have to be romantic stuff, it can just be friendships. You know, if you like being friends with people who are different from yourself. There's good reasons for that. Now, consider a different kind of difference, a difference that makes all the difference. What if they're a scumbag? Are you a scumbag? Does that attract you? I'm not a scumbag, so I need somebody who's going to make my life complete by being the scumbag in my life so I can experience that kind of thing and, you know, see things from their perspective. Now, Cicero doesn't use that term, but he says, here we go. Honest men are excessively grieved by the dishonest. If you're an honest person, doesn't it bug you to see people lying? You know, I can't stand politics myself because I have this, you know, I mean, this is part of why I'm in philosophy. I have this sense that we ought to actually tell the truth about things. And telling the truth doesn't just mean telling your perspective or, you know, a portion of the story or, you know, what you feel like at the time. It means actually like doing the research and figuring out what's actually the case and then only saying that. You know, not throwing in extra digs against your opponent or things like that. Not complaining about things that you yourself endorsed a couple years ago. For me, all that's disgusting. I find that actually disgusting in people. I cannot be friends with a person who behaves that way. So there's no way I can be friends with a lot of people who are in politics, because there's something about, at least American politics, that tends to bring that out in people. The brave by the cowardly. If you actually have guts, do you like people who don't? I mean, you may actually get screwed by them because you expect them to actually behave the way you would. You know, think about standing up for your friends. If you stand up for your friends, don't you expect them to stand up for you? This is not going to work in that case, this difference principle here. Sober lives and the dissolute. A sober life would mean one that's well ordered. You guys are probably, for the most part, living fairly sober lives as students, I'm guessing. Any of you who have jobs right now, you're probably living a fairly sober life. Can you be friends for a long time with somebody who just, imagine they're on a trust fund and they can do whatever they want. And they, in fact, just do whatever they want. Can you be a lasting friend with them? Probably not. Here's another thing to think about, too. Do people who are cowards like people who are brave? They may admire them. Can they be friends with them very long, or do they turn on them? People who are dishonest. What do they say about honest people? They're tactless. They should know better. They can't really be friends with them. So there has to be some other basis. And here's where it's quite interesting. Similarity is not the same thing as nature, is not the same thing as virtue. There's something inherently attractive about moral goodness, Cicero says. Something that draws us to people who actually have goodness, or at least the appearance of it. We can be deceived, right? I can think that you're actually honest, because you display yourself that way for a while, but then it turns out that you're really not. I can think that you're actually brave and you have principles and you stick to them, but it turned out that, you know, that was only for a semester. But that sort of thing is attractive. Even to the people who lack those things, they're in sort of a love-hate relationship with that. But those who actually have something on the ball, they do have something that they can count on. And he talks about this. He says, this is where it goes beyond Aristotle a little bit. He says, there's nothing more lovable than virtue, surely nothing which more wins affectionate regard. And then he goes through a bunch of examples of people. And he says, you have to have good faith between people. And love, he says, is indeed strengthened by favors received, by witnessing assiduity. That's sort of like taking care of things, what would we call it these days? Being on the ball in one service, and by habitual interaction. And when these are added to the first impulse of the mind towards love, there flames forth a marvelously rich glow of affectionate feeling. If there are any who think this proceeds from conscious weakness and the desire to have some person through whom one can obtain what he lacks, they assign indeed to friendship a mean and utterly ignoble origin. when we are actually friends with somebody on the basis of these sorts of things, it's not that we need something from them. He has this example. He says, did Scipio Africanus need me? This guy was totally on top of things. There's really nothing he needed from me. That doesn't mean that he didn't desire anything from me. I was drawn to him by admiration of his virtue. He in turn loved me, perhaps from some favorable estimate of my character. And intimacy increased our mutual affection. Many good things, many what he calls utilities, usefulnesses, resulted from that. But the friendship, a real friendship, is not based on that. It's based on the fact that virtue or goodness, let's just say goodness, is attractive. To the person who's a friend. And goodness, by its very nature, by being goodness, is going to produce benefits. But the virtuous person doesn't give benefits to the other person because they want to get something out of them. That's the nature of goodness, to be sort of overflowing. Does this get us to the point, you remember earlier in the semester we contrasted, say, this notion of agape, this kind of self-giving love? With philia, which is friendship. A lot of people want to say, in order to have agape, it's got to have a religious sort of basis to it. So, you know, St. Paul, for example, writes a lot about agape, a Christian writer. You can read that into the older Jewish scriptures too. You know, God's love for people. Does God actually need anything from people? Not a lot you can do for God. When you're a good person or a bad person, it doesn't change God at all, right? It's not going to like take anything away from him. He's not counting on you to show up and pick him up on time, or you know, remember your anniversary or things like that, right? So he just gives because that's the nature. It overflows. Goodness overflows. That's there in Cicero. That's the nature of actual virtue. But it's a bit more restricted. With Christianity, you know, somebody like St. Paul coming along, or you look at the Sermon on the Mount, who are you supposed to exhibit this sort of thing to? The people who deserve it? The people who are, you know, also good? The people who are like halfway good, no, even to the dirtbags. You know, somebody strikes you in the face, that turn the other cheek thing is not just about, you know, somebody coming up to you and giving you a little slap. They're giving you a good punch. And you let them do that one more time. Somebody asks you for a shirt off their back, you don't say, well, I don't know, are you a good friend? Or are you kind of a scumbag? You just give it to them. Somebody wants you to go 1 mile, go two. You've all heard these verses before, right? So it's not quite the same thing on Cicero's part, this self-giving love, but it's there. Reflections of it are there in Cicero's discussions. Virtue is something that is inherently productive. Let's talk about some of the traits of a real friendship now that he talks about. He has this word that becomes very important in the Middle Ages. What are you loving? Loving in return. That is at the core of friendship, he says. Since virtue attracts friendship, if there shines forth any manifestation of virtue with which a mind similarly disposed can come into contact and union, from such intercourse love must of necessity spring. So you don't have to be completely virtuous, you just have to have some seeds, some beginning points of virtue in you. For the other person, who's not just thinking about making a buck, getting laid, having a good time, that sort of thing, to see and to respond to. And then, if they have that in them, you have that in you, you can respond to them as well. And then he says, what is so absurd as to be charmed with many things that have no substantial worth, like office, fame, architecture, dress, and genteel appearance, but not to be in any wise charmed by a mind endowed with virtue and capable of either loving or, if I may say the word, he's coining a new term, re-loving, loving in return. Being in a relationship where between the friend and the friend, there is love back and forth. Love that's partly based on a response to who the friend is, partly based on the fact that you have that love to give to the other person. It's on the basis of goodness in the friend that attracts that love. It's on the basis of the goodness which the friend possesses that allows them to give that love. Here we are seeing something going beyond what we've seen so far. What else? He talks about this love giving delight. And I think there's a greater emphasis in Cicero on love as not just being a response to something else, the desire, something that we feel towards the other person, there's also a consciousness of the fact that we enjoy being loved. That was there in Plato, that was there in Aristotle, but it's being much more, being made much more explicit here. We like to be liked by other people. We like for other people to feel affectionately and behave affectionately towards us. When friendships break up, it's quite often because we lack that. And this is the last thing I'm going to hit on. He also gives us some discussions of why it is that friendships dissolve. Why friendships don't continue. And, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to make a little change in our semester, our syllabus. We'll spend 2 days on this.